Hello, ITS Digital Signage Content Managers. This video is an introduction to Content Manager Desktop, or CMD. This video covers the basics, how to connect to CMD, where your network stores can be found, a tour of Fwi's, and how do you send commands. To connect to Content Manager Desktop, or CMD for short, you'll need Microsoft Remote Desktop. This product is available by default on all PC computers, but you would need to load it on a Mac through the App Store. It's not purchased, but you do need to load it. Depending on your credentials, you may need the help of your IT organization to allow you to install something. Once Remote Desktop is installed, you'll need to connect to a computer, the Remote Desktop. The address for that desktop is dsw-digitalsignage.adsroot.itcs.umich.edu. I recommend that you pause the film right now, take down the name off the screen, and use that connect. Once you've connected, it's going to ask you for a password. For our university users, that's just your normal password that you would use to log into anything from your email to this server. Once you've connected to the Remote Desktop, you're going to be greeted with this desktop right here. There are two icons to cover. The first one is this Content Manager Desktop icon. Looks like a private eye icon, the green thing here. The second one is going to be this folder. This is the DSW Customer Content folder. It's going to take you to the network storage for digital signage content. It's the one that we provide to you as part of the service. We recommend that you use this. You don't have to, but it is recommended. The reason for that is it is accessible to you, the content manager, and only your department for your folder through read and write, and to the sign for read only, and then most importantly to the ITS digital signage administrators for troubleshooting purposes. That means that if you deploy something to sign, we can see it and we can see what you're seeing to try to help you out with any troubleshooting. The other reason to use this content store, this network storage, is because it is web accessible. The entire contents here are being hosted in read-only fashion onto the internet to allow the new system-on-a-chip signs, the smart TV-based signs, to allow them to see this content. Those smart TVs are smart, but not smart enough to access our network locations, but they can see an HTTP address as being shown here. Once you put them in here, you can use them on smart signs. That's going to change our best practices previously from using a UNC path to using this HTTPS address to access content. We'll talk about that more in the module about live data. Next, let's talk about getting your specific folder. No doubt when you entered here, you saw all these folders with all these abbreviations and you're going, which one of these is mine? You're going to look for your unit prefix. This will be the prefix that's assigned to you by digital signage. Often this is the university prefix, but because we have so many departments that don't have a university prefix, we have to make them up. So we will tell you what that is when you become a digital signage customer, and then you're going to find your folder. You cannot access anybody else's folder, and they can't access yours. Additionally, the signs that you have cannot access anybody else's folder, but they can read from yours. Okay, it's time to jump into CMD. You're going to double click on that magnifying glass icon in the top left-hand corner, and it's going to start to load Content Manager. Keep in mind that CMD does take a while to load. It is loading everybody's signs, even though you cannot see them. For our convenience, I've already loaded a copy of this. Do not do what I did here. Don't load two copies. You're going to end up saving over yourself, and it's going to ask you if you want to confirm changes that you made in one window or the other, and you will lose some work. So only load one at a time. The first section that we want to talk about, this content types panel that's over on the left-hand side, we recommend that you close this. This is used to create content items in the root directory. As standard users, you don't have access to the root directory, so anything created using this won't be accessible to you. The next section that we need to talk about is in network overview. This is now in the top left-hand corner. There are going to be two icons that are immediately apparent. One of those is going to be all these little pink buildings. You probably only have two. One is going to be your specific unit grouping. The other one is going to be for emergency alerts. These are under the blue planet of University of Michigan Digital Signage. That's our grouping under Fwi's. These groupings, these pink buildings, are built into logical kind of sections for the administrator's benefit so that we can find your signs in this sea of signs. So let's say, for example, that you work for Sites Printing and you need to find your signs. Your signs are going to be under Informational Technology Services. You're going to open up that tree and then you'll see subtrees under here for Campus Community Sites and then Sites Printing. Now you can, if you need to, create your own locations within your locations so that you can break out signs into logical units of your own if you need to organize them. For example, Sites Printing here has broken them out into the buildings where Sites Printing has a presence. That makes it easier for them to manage. The other location that you're going to see at the top of the tree by default is the emergency alerts channels. These are viewable to everyone, but you don't need to concern with them and you won't be able to adjust them because the permissions are set up that way. We assign them to your sign for you. That way they cannot be adjusted and accidentally broken and break the emergency alerts across the entire digital signage fleet. Now, where are the actual signs? If you drill down through the locations to the bottom of the tree, you'll find your digital signs listed under there. These should be named something logical, ideally with the room number and building number, and then maybe the serial number for the specific player that is associated with that sign. Next stop on our tour is the timeline. This is in the upper right-hand side. This is going to show you when signs or templates or content are scheduled to show when they start, when they stop. This purple line here is referencing that template in saying that this template is started from the beginning of time till the end of time as it stretches across the entire screen. If there was an interrupt in it, say that if it wasn't supposed to show on Sundays, you would not see the purple line there for just that Sunday section. It would skip over it and then start back up on Monday. If we drill down here into these regions, you will see content being scheduled to show or not scheduled to show, as the case may be. That is represented by the yellow line stretching across the entire timeline. If you need to, you can change the range of the time that you're looking at by clicking the magnifying glass in the top left-hand corner of the timeline. That'll allow you to scrub back and forth, seeing greater time frames or burrowing in even deeper and seeing hour by hour what's scheduled to show. Additionally, you can also use the pink line that you'll see on the timeline to scrub forward and back to see what would happen at a sign at a specific time. Remember, this is not a live showing of your sign. This is a preview, so you can preview in advance saying, here, show me what's going to be shown 2 hours in the future. Now let's talk about these buttons in the top center of the screen, right above the network overview. These control several functions within FourWinds. The first one on the left is the Fwi Store icon. This allows access to a repository of templates and content that are available from the FourWinds vendor. Unfortunately, because they're all controlled by a single password, which we're not able to share out with content managers, you wouldn't have access directly. Instead, the administrators, like myself, will pull anything that is intended for higher ed and share that out in repositories for content, templates, and then we will implement any apps that we believe are appropriate for the university. The second button is the play button. If you are selecting your sign or template and you hit this play button, it's going to show you a preview of what the sign would do based on your settings in your timeline. So if you do play for today, it shows you what you do today. If you show the play button from Tuesday, it's going to show that. The third button, if you click on a template, that's going to show you an outline of what a template looks like with the different regions labeled. The last one is the network monitor, and that's going to be your next subject. The network monitor gives you network information about your sign. It also gives you information that the computer, the PC running your sign, sends back. By default, it's going to start with the name of the player. This is what you named it in FourWinds CMD, so not the name of the PC itself. The next column here is application status. This is the status of the FWI player application on that PC. Device status used to serve that purpose, so ignore that, it's no longer used. Then there is the version. This is the versions of the player software that is running on that particular PC or SoC sign. It should be in green. Right now it's 5.15. You can add additional information to this screen by going into the Select Columns button here in the top. You see it clicked on, and then you have a bunch of things that you can add. By far, the most popular is Screenshot. These are in alphabetical order, but as you scroll down, you'll see Screenshot there. If you click on it, and then importantly, refresh the network monitor, you will see the most recent screenshot that was sent from the player to CMD. Commands are sent to either a specific player or a group of players by selecting the location or the specific player, right-clicking, and select Send Command. Once the new panel opens, you need to add a command line. So click the plus button in the bottom left-hand corner, and then go to the command that you want to select from the drop-down menu in the top right. In this case, the command is Upload Screenshot. It's at the bottom of the list. Leave the settings here as default. Click OK, and it'll send the command to the player or players that you selected. If you see a green line that says Command Sent Successful, you're good to go. If it's red, you might want to check to see that the player's on. If it is, that indicates some sort of a network issue or a Windows issue, and send us a ticket. We'll do what we can to help you out with that. Once you're done here, click Close. Don't forget in the network overview to refresh to see screenshots. Now let's talk about these three tabs at the bottom. These are content, templates, and apps. Content is where you're going to spend most of your time creating content to go onto your sign. It's going to be anything from live data to clocks to RSS feeds to videos. The second tab is your templates. This is the boxes that you're going to fit content into. You need a template for a sign for it to do anything. This last section is apps. These are pre-configured solutions that are created by ITS to fill different needs, mostly to provide an out-of-the-box solution. Some of these are just content libraries, like a NASA image of the day. Some of them are entire signs that are signs out of a box that will just do a thing to put on your sign so that you can get up and running quickly. Thank you for taking the time to watch this. If you're continuing on, the next video should be content and templates. We'll see you there.